And without further ado, let's get started.
Okay, and by the way, there's a handout for the for tonight's program. If you don't have one of these, there's some extras on the seats. Can somebody raise their hand if they know where the extras are?
They're right there. You got them there?
Okay, so if you need, and I also have a handout, one page that has 8 slides on it, front and back. So if you want to follow along and write notes, you can take it home, you can take that. So there's more people back there. Okay, so with that, we'll start. I have a little timer here. Okay, so does evolution falsify Adam as a first human? This is a topic that's really important to me. Let's go to the next slide. What evidence, okay, so here's the overview of what I'm going to talk about today. I'm going to talk about the evidence for evolution and what some religious criticisms are, and then how do some people reconcile evolution with theology. John is not one who accepts evolution, so he doesn't have to do that, but I want to take a grand picture of some Christians who try that. Next page. Okay. So what evidence is there for evolution? I think since the year 2000, they've actually decoded the human DNA, all the human DNA for the first time, and since then they've decoded a lot of other animals, and they've compared the DNA across animals, and this is called genomics. It's a science. And with that, I think there's very two strong evidences for evolution. There's many of them, but I'm going to bring up two that I think are unassailable. So the first one, next page, is on pseudogenes. Let's go to the next page. There we go. See, what you see here is pseudogenes are basically genes, according to evolutionary theory, that we inherited from our ancestors, different species, and they're busted genes. So what this chart shows, for example, if you look at the very top, it says humans have 15 pseudogenes. Well, this is just part of the olfactory sense, part of the smelling, you know, the things that we smell, the odors. So, so for example, humans have 15 wrecked versions of this that they inherited. So in other words, we can't smell certain odors that other animals can. Chimps have a different 4, gorilla have 5, and orangutans have 11. These are all different, okay? So when you go down the tree there, you see the 3. The 3 is underneath the branch of humans and chimp. That means that humans and chimp inherit these 3 broken genes. The gorilla and the orangutan don't have it. If you go down to the next branch, you go to the common ancestor between the gorilla and the chimp and the human, okay? And there's 3 more there. So everybody underneath that inherited those 3. At the very bottom, there's 1 there. That 1 pseudogene is something that all of these species have inherited. So when you look at this, in every case of pseudogenes, they can see patterns of descent where a broken gene is inherited. And you might say, well, maybe it just evolved, maybe just modified in some way, and another one modified another way in a different animal, you know, unrelated. Well, this is how you can see it happens according to ancestry. So either these are inherited, or else God designed creatures independently and made it look as if they descended, which would make God lying, deceiving God, which is not good for theology. So most Christians would not claim that. Let's go to the next page. It's fused human chromosome number 2. What this shows is that there's 1 less pair of chromosomes in humans and chimps. And since, again, the year 2000, they decoded the DNA, and we found out why humans have 1 less. It's because if you look at 2 of the chimp chromosomes, it looks like they fused, and then they're similar to the human. And now, how do we know that's how the human came about? Because at the end of every chromosome, they have what they call telomeres. And in the center of each chromosome, there's what they call a centromere. So when these 2 fused, there's these telomeres, which are normally at the end. Now they're also in the middle, because they met in the end, in the middle. And because of this also, there's 2 centromeres in there instead of just 1. And so when you look at the human fused genome, number 2, the chromosome number 2, you see the broken centromere in there, and then you see the accurate centromere being used, and that's the one that's in the bottom one. So basically, one of the centromeres atrophied, and one of them worked, and then the 2 telomeres in the middle are now deactivated. So again, either this perfectly explains how there's a relationship between humans evolving from some common ancestor, or else God, if he made humans from scratch, he put this in there to make it appear so. So you have to ask, why is God building things from scratch and putting in unused centromeres and extra telomeres and things like that? Just to, it looks like, again, he's a deceiving God. He did that on purpose. Next page. What criticisms are there? I'm going to go over some of these just basically really quickly. There's young earth creationists. They believe this is a small group of evangelical Christians, but they're very vocal, like Ken Ham with the Creation Museum in Kansas. And, you know, he has a thing called presuppositionalism, which means basically he starts with his belief and then he looks for evidence to confirm it. And he says, for example, when you find a fossil, it doesn't come with a tag and say this was made in the year, you know, whatever. He says creationists look at it through their mind, their worldview of 6,000 years, and evolutionists look at their worldview of, you know, millions or billions of years, and that's why they have different ideas. Well, that's not really the way science works. The way science works is you look at the data, you build a hypothesis, you build a prediction, and you test it, and then revise accordingly. And one of the things that scientists hate, one of the things they look out for to demolish in themselves and others, is confirmation bias. That means you don't look just to confirm your own biases, you want to try to make sure that you're looking at the big picture and looking at it soundly and soberly. And so basically this presuppositionism, in my view, is actually just confirmation bias on stilts. You know, it's basically lifting up confirmation bias as if it's something good, when it's the thing that you really want to destroy in your own thinking. So confirmation bias is listed as a logical fallacy if you want to look it up on the internet for more information. Then there's also old earth creationism, where Reasons to Believe is a ministry website like that, with Hugh Ross and Fazale Ron, and Ronna wrote a book called The Cell's Design, How Chemistry Reveals the Creator's Artistry. And basically the idea is that life is so amazing it must be designed. I mean, it's like the woman who looks at a baby in her arms and says, there must be a God, look at this baby, it's just so wonderfully made. You know, it's just struck by the complexity. But I think the antidote to that kind of thinking is, like, Richard Dawkins had a talk one time about what he called large world, medium world, and small world. And since we evolved in this medium world, we're used to things like minutes and miles, those kind of scales, but we can't comprehend things on the very small world or the very large world. So, for example, in the very small world, there's weird quantum effects, such as quantum tunneling, quantum entanglement. And these have no counterparts that we could experience in our kind of existence. And so for us, they're very perplexing. You know, how do we explain that? We can't. We're still trying to figure out that stuff in the small world. We can't say it's like this in our world because it operates totally different. But some people don't understand that, and they say, oh, it's just hard to believe, okay. And it's like they prefer to believe in magic. Oh, God did it by magic. How do you make light? How is lightning made? Who made it? God made it, you know, and then they found out how are earthquakes made, but God made it. But then they found out, like tectonics, you know, same thing with tsunamis. So basically science is really discovering things that just are really counterintuitive to us because of our experience. So, and then intelligent design, this is promoted by the Discovery Institute. Basically it's a wide tent of everybody who disagrees with evolution. And there's a big mix in it, a wide mix, like Michael Behe is in there, for example, and he accepts that humans evolved from other animals like apes, but some of them don't. But they all reject that you could have just nature creating this without a God. Okay, next page. So how do Christians reconcile this? Well, Catholics have been known to accept evolution, but one thing the Pope has said, and nobody has really counteracted this in 1950, is he basically said, you know, evolution's fine as long as you believe we all said it from one man, Adam and Eve. Well, the problem is evolution works over population and time. At no point does a human pop out of a non-human. Again, I'll say that. At no point does a human pop out of a non-human. It works in populations over time. That's how all changes work. There's no such thing as a first fish, no such thing as a first human, a first frog, a first rabbit, first any species. So anyway, that's a problem that the Pope has. He basically says you're not allowed as a Catholic to believe that we basically came from a population of hominids. He believes that we all came from Adam and Eve and inherited that. So basically, I'm just going to jump to my conclusion now, and that is, let's go to two more. Skip the next one. One more. So basically, I want to say, you know, I don't mean this as an insult. This is really how I believe. I really do believe that God does not exist, just like Santa Claus does not exist. Just as Santa Claus is in your mind as an imaginary character, I think that's the same about God. So I'm not saying that to put anybody down. That's just honestly how I feel. And I think that when you see the world through naturalistic eyes, things will make sense. But as long as you try to keep the ancient scriptures with modern science, there's always going to be a problem. So, time's up. Thank you.